Well, good afternoon. My name is Charles Baer, and I'm the director of the Rotman Institute of Philosophy at the University of Western Ontario. It's my distinct pleasure to welcome all of you this afternoon's events. I'd like to add a special welcome to the hundreds of viewers who are joining us as we broadcast live on YouTube. We're here to celebrate the official opening of the Rotman Institute of Philosophy and hear the annual Rotman Institute lecture in philosophy and science. The Rotman Institute of Philosophy was created through a generous donation from the Rotman Family Foundation and matching funds from the University of Western Ontario. At the heart of the Rotman Institute is a vision of engagement. Philosophers engaging scientists to make a difference in the world. Faculty and students of the Rotman Institute of Philosophy work on issues that engage a remarkable swath of contemporary science, including quantum mechanics, early universe cosmology, evolution, and clinical trials in medicine. Although we're a young institute, we already enjoy valued working relationships with scientists at the Perimeter Institute, Western Center for Human Immunology, and the Ottawa Hospital Research. We're philosophers who think through difficult questions regarding science and technology, whether it's thinking through the ethical consequences of technological innovations before they hit the market, or debating the appropriate goals of publicly funded research. Scientists have the expertise and the knowledge to develop solutions to many of the challenges we face in the modern world. Collaboration with philosophers can help ensure that society guides scientific research appropriately and responds to research results productively. We're joined by three very special guests to celebrate the official opening, and then we're going to transition into the annual Rotman Lecture. So first, the official opening. Each of our guests will say a few words about the Rotman Institute of Philosophy. Our first speaker is Dr. Janice Deakin, Provost and Vice President of Academic for the University of Western Ontario.
Thank you, Charles. I want to begin by welcoming our guests here to Common Hall, as well as to those people who are watching online, and thank you for joining us on this special day of celebration for the liberal arts. I also want to extend a very special welcome to the Rotman Institute's Advisory Committee, and thank you for traveling from distances afar to join us here today. Today's event is an extremely tangible acknowledgement of the vital role that philosophy plays in the building of a just society, a society that is comprised of thoughtful and compassionate citizens, scientists, and leaders. By several measures, I've come to learn very quickly since I've only been at Western a couple of months that the philosophy department here, and in particular the philosophy of science, is a signature area of strength for this university, and one that helps position Western as a world leader. It was just over 2 years ago when one of Western's most distinguished graduates, a philosophy graduate, stepped forward to announce that he wanted to invest in the special strength we have in philosophy and help us elevate its profile to an impact on a global scale. Joseph Rotman is a person known to many for his extraordinary success as a businessman, and equally so for his extraordinary generosity as a philanthropist. Fewer people, however, may know that Joe attributes part of his success to his studies here at Western as a philosophy major. Now, as a provost and vice president academic, I have to say that there are very few things more gratifying than seeing an alumni go on to achieve great things in their lives and their careers, and then hear them laying claim that the foundation on which they built their success comes from the education that they received here at Western. What's even more gratifying is when alumni like Joe return to campus to invest in the future of the institution, to invest in our students, to invest in our faculty, and in the society that we serve. So on behalf of Western, I want to express our deepest gratitude to you, Joe, for sharing our vision in the future of philosophy and science at Western. Through your philanthropy and through your example, you have provided us with the financial resources and an inspiration to build on our strength in philosophy, to continue to raise the bar on the quality of education that we can provide to our students. And on that note, I'd like to recognize the Rotman Institute's director, Charles Baer, the chair of Western's Department of Philosophy, Samantha Brennan, and Donna Pinnade, who is the Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Humanities, for their collective leadership and effort in building the Institute together. Together, these individuals and their colleagues are building an academic enterprise that engages people across a multitude of disciplines through collaborative teaching and research. You are all doing great work here, and we share in your pride in seeing that this Institute has lifted to a great meaning. I join you, Joe, and many others here on campus and beyond who are interested in seeing this Institute reach its full potential on a global scale. And briefly, just before I return the podium to Charles, I want to acknowledge that our fundraising campaign at Western is focused on achieving three higher order objectives. We will develop leaders, we'll build on our strengths, and we will elevate Western's position in a global context. And it's easy to see how those three ambitions fit very nicely with the objectives of the Rotman Institute of Philosophy. So as we move forward in our capital campaign and our fundraising campaign, we will continue to seek opportunities to provide the Rotman Institute of Philosophy and other areas of strength with the resources that they need to help Western attract and develop global leaders of tomorrow. We are at the beginning of a very exciting journey here, and we are committed to supporting the success of the ambitious people and their endeavors here. So to all of you who are affiliated with the Rotman Institute of Philosophy, I wish you all the best for continued success. Thank you.
Dramatic change. when our country is influenced by science and technology, whether through healthcare, information technology, physics, biology, genetics. Because of my training in philosophy, I soon realized that certain hard questions were not being asked. I saw that certain assumptions needed to be challenged. Fortunately, during this time, Dr. Paul Davenport cold called me as a salesman as president in the second year of his initial term. He personally, along with Grant Sterling, who's in the audience, helped me move along a path to understand the strength of philosophy at Western and the opportunity to do something significant. That led to the establishment of a chair as my initial act, and Bob Batterman, who is here today somewhere, is the first appointment of that. But after meeting the students and the faculty in the department, I saw an incredible opportunity. I became convinced that we really could do something important here at Western that was unique. And I realized we could have an impact in helping define the scope of the problem that we face because of the rapid change we're experiencing with science and technology, as well as to ensure that we advance questions that are not being asked. I've seen the same situation in a field of which I know a lot more about than philosophy, in business and economics, which is what I trained at after I left Western, both at the U of T and at Columbia University in New York. Many economists are now reluctant to confront rising income inequality directly, saying that whether this trend is good or bad requires a value judgment. And a value judgment is not the job of us as economists. That is best left to philosophers. Economics, however, was founded by moral philosophers, but separated as disciplines. They are now again collaborating and coming together instead of the separate silos. Most people don't realize that Adam Smith, the father of modern economics, was a professor of moral philosophy at the University of Glasgow. His first book was A Theory of Moral Sentiments, which was published 25 years before his famous book, The Wealth of Nations. But The Wealth of Nations, which most people don't talk about, and I would urge most people in philosophy or any other department to read, is also covered with very trenchant moral analysis. Income equality over the last 20 years has grown immensely, and it has imposed considerable harm on our society without necessarily knowing if it has generated significant benefits. And therefore, the integration of economics and philosophy had to come together. We must do the same with science, technology, through the lens of philosophers. Thank you.
Together and adapted the ideas for the Institute. those of us who have spent time in philosophy departments know that they don't usually get along that well. There usually are deep antagonisms and factions, and they're really hard to get over. And this department, I think, has been quite remarkable in figuring out how to work with those and beyond those to embrace this institute and make the idea even better than it was in the first place. The idea of engaging science in all sorts of ways is really important, and it's a great opportunity. It's really promising also, and really important. Yesterday I talked to the program officer in the US, you know, I know they're always behind, but the National Science Foundation, the program officer who works with history and philosophy of science, he had just come from a meeting with the division director and his various bosses, and they just told him that they were going to cut, not cut out, but cut radically back the funding for history and philosophy of science program, because history and philosophy of science is not real science, and it's not important, and in bad economic times, it's easy to cut out. It's more important to study other core areas of the social sciences, like economics. And I would like to say, not that they've done so well. Philosophers and historians are really important. So we need this now more than ever, this philosophy engaged in science. We also need it to respond to people like Stephen Hawking in his recent book, The Grand Design. And there's a quotation from Hawking, which is on the website, with responses from a lot of people here. And it's very interesting for those who haven't looked at it. You should look at the Rotman Institute website. Hawking said, people have always asked a multitude of questions. How can we understand the world in which we find ourselves? How does the universe behave? What is the nature of reality? Where did all this come from? Did the universe need a creator? You know, those questions. Traditionally, he goes on, traditionally, these are questions for philosophy, but philosophy is dead. Philosophy has not kept up with modern developments in the sciences. Scientists have become the bearers of the torch for discovery in our quest for knowledge, sort of setting aside philosophers. And as I said, locally, folks have had really interesting things to say about why Hawking is wrong, But we need this institute to promote thinking about why it's wrong. And we need Philip Kitcher as well. So Philip Kitcher, so I'm introducing him now, second part of my job. He's the distinguished lecturer and the perfect choice for this official launching of the Institute, because he is a public intellectual who thinks just about these issues of how philosophy can engage science and engage the world. He has deep and incisive philosophical thinking, engaging and illuminating science in its public role. Philip started out in England and then studied at Cambridge and then started moving west, more or less. So he went to Princeton with Tom Kuhn, went to Vassar, kind of north a little bit, Vassar, Vermont, Minnesota, UCSD, and then a little retrograde motion. So now he's back in Columbia, where he seems stuck. So he's the John Dewey Professor of Philosophy at Columbia. He's played many, really all of the leading service roles, editor, president, yada, 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 all those important things, won all the important awards. We'll list them all. You can look them up. Those websites out of date, but you can look them up. And he's got a lot of books. His books take up the challenges of explaining philosophy and mathematics, Wagner's Ring, Finnegan's Wake, and philosophy of science. So in philosophy of science, he's got them all too. Sociobiology, genetic engineering, evolution and creationism. His book, Science, Truth, and Democracy, is really a masterpiece, published in 2001, widely read in a variety of classes, not just philosophy of science, but many other places. His most recent book is Living with Darwin, Evolution, Design, and the Future of Faith. And he has a project underway that he says will be out in fall of 2011 with Harvard, so look for that, the Ethical Project. Look for that in Amazon or bookstore, whichever you like. As Garrison Keillor puts it, they're life's persistent questions that guide Mars studies. Keillor's model, but that Philip Kitcher studies as well. So Phil is going to study or talk today on the first part of a two-part series. So today is a lecture, and then another tomorrow. This is part of a series that's going to become another book. so we can look forward to hearing more about it. Science in a Democratic Society is the book in the larger project, and now he's going to talk to us about authority, responsibility, and democracy. Hello, Kitcher.
Even more.